And has posted a super result in qualifying, Andy Raymond.
The car has garnered plenty of interest and Team Holden have given little away. In its debut performance, Craig Lowndes, it's been outstanding.
It has been. One reason why we didn't run a Phillip Island because we didn't believe it was up to speed with the old one. We believe it is now, so it's a bit hard because unfortunately the old one's in repair mode, but when we get the old one back, we'll have a good back-to-back test and see how much quicker it is or isn't. But at the moment, yeah, it is quick enough.
Very briefly, is the car that different?
It is slightly. I'm sitting a little bit further back. The roll cage, it makes the car a little bit stiffer. It's a little bit different to drive. It's a little bit different to set up than the old cars. I believe it's got it's good and bad points, but I think it's got more good points than bad. So at the moment, yeah, it's going well.
Let's look how they line up today. Craig Lowndes and Peter Brock on the front row with row two, Dick Johnson and John Bow in the Shell duo.
Third row of the grid, Larry Perkins and Mark Scape share that one, then Glenn Seaton and Russell Ingall.
Out of row five, Tony Longhurst and Alan Jones. Row six, Wayne Gardner and John Faulkner.
On the seventh row for this round of the championship, Paul Romano and Stephen Richards, followed by Mark Larkham and Max Dumsney.
Out of row nine, Greg Crick and Stephen Ellery. Row 10, David Parsons and Mal Rose.
The 11th row, Steve Reed and Mark Poole, and at the rear of the grid, Chris Merton.
Seconds away now from the start of round six. Shell Australian Touring Car Championship for 1996. A Holden Racing team, all front row. Two Shell Fords on the second row. Lowndes has done it again. Absolutely bullet start off the pole position. But John Bow has made an equally brilliant start off the second row, muscling up alongside the HRT Commodore as they fly down toward turn one. Big pack of V8s screaming down here to Repco Corner for the first time. It's Lowndes in the lead, Bow in second position, Castrol Commodore in third. Look at them shuffle through here. Very, very tight conditions as they try and sort the field out as they come over the rise for the first time.
Well, the starts are an amazing important part of this, and Brock's missed two now, and Craig hasn't missed any, so you'd have to wonder whether they've got the same ability to get the cars off the line.
Look at this big attack from Perkins. I think it is up there. So no, it's Ingall, car 8, his teammate. They're side by side as they come through the Shell S's. Bow's out on the rough stuff. There's someone else in trouble there too. Yep, Mark Poole, the privateer from South Australia. Big flick spin, tries to get the car back onto the track. All sorts of mayhem. Look at Peter Brock getting very, very sideways as they come out onto the main straight for the first time. So the field getting sorted out, and Lowndes absolutely blistering first lap, just sprints away from the pack. And here's the two Shell Fords in third and fourth. Thundering down toward Repco Corner for the first time, reaching speeds of 260 kilometres an hour before they brake very hard. Big brake lock-up from Dick Johnson. Very fast here in qualifying. And there's Glenn Seaton.
Disaster for him in a 20-lap around Calder. There's not much time to come, and he's putting it away, and that's the right thing.
Dunlop race cam aboard Shell, number 17. Dick Johnson hard at work, looking up at his mirrors with Peter Brock breathing right down his neck. Brock goes on the outside, hard under brakes from 260 kilometres an hour. Back to second gear, looking for plenty of bite out of these slow corners. Into turn two.
It's very hard for Brock to go around the outside there, and he's really probably not planning on doing that. What he's trying to do is get up beside Dick and drag him down so Dick will outbrake himself and shoot off the end of the road or spin, because to go around the outside there is a virtually impossible thing. But Brock just wants to keep on reminding him that he's there and he's putting pressure on him and he wants to get by.
Lowndes has opened it up 4.1 seconds last time around. He's absolutely streaking the field as he's done previous meetings over a second a lap, opening up the gap over the rest of the V8 pack.
With Lowndes and Brock off the front row in this race, and Johnson and Bauer for second row, statistician Nigel Greenway tells me it's the first time two teams have occupied the front two rows of the grid in the history of the Australian Touring Car Championship.
Sign of how competitive it is amongst the top four and hold teams. Johnson, Shell team, surprisingly quick here. So this is a local Victorian circuit, Holden Racing team, and Glenn Seaton, two test a lot down here. And they're doing a terrific job in the Queensland-based Fords. Up over the hump, out of turn three. Accelerating up to 180, 190 kilometres an hour as they come through the flip-flop. Absolutely flat, bouncing the wheels up on the curbs, building up to just under 230 kilometres an hour as they brake hard for the Shell S's.
Craig Lowndes still the only driver into the 56s, 56.20 last lap. All the others in the 57s, from Russell Ingall right down to Wayne Gardner in seventh place.
Well, he's opened it up again, Wilco. 4.9, almost 5 seconds that time around. Lowndes is absolutely bolting away.
And Brock's probably starting to get quite frustrated here. He's definitely got a faster car at the moment, but there's just no way that he can do anything about it. And Bow looks to be holding these two up a little bit as well. They're certainly quite close.
Look at Dick Johnson closing off all the options for Brock. Runs right down the inside, breaks right up to the apex of the corner. doesn't give Brock any opportunity up the inside. He's got to go the long way around, and that's very tough on this track. Quite narrow through here. High, unforgiving curbs. You can see the cars bouncing off them, and they get a little bit out of shape. So Johnson under enormous pressure from Peter Brock.
Larry Perkins getting on the tail of this trio now too.
And that'll make it a little bit harder for Brock, because he'll have to have a look in the mirror. When he makes an attempt to go around the outside of Dick somewhere, he'll have to be careful that Larry doesn't nip up the inside of him and place him back one more spot in the queue.
Now look at this man just running away from the pack.
Well, they've called this the new HRT supercar, and that's a super performance so far. They had the wraps on the car literally this week. Don't know why, but they've pulled them off today. And here are the top placings on the Shell race score. Craig Lowndes the leader from Russell Ingall, John Bauer in third spot, then Dick Johnson, Peter Brock rounding up the five. The battle for fourth and fifth, Dick Johnson, Peter Brock. It continues up front. Craig Lowndes easily leads Russell Ingall, John Bauer in third spot, then Johnson and Brock in this great battle. Perkins right on their tail. Andy Raymond's got from news for us in the pits.
Yeah, and it's not good news, Gary. Glenn Seaton on the warm-up lap, you dropped the cylinder.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to it, Andy, but as soon as I left the line to do the warm-up lap, but just dropped on the seven cylinders. It wasn't really bad early, and it just got progressively worse, so I decided to bring it in now, and we'll change an engine. We'll put a new fresh engine in, and gives us a bit more time between now and the next race.
We'll see you back out there.
Yeah, thanks, Andy.
Thanks, Andy. And Seaton obviously very despondent, dropping the cylinder there. And hopefully back in action for Heat 2 as he tries to keep his championship hopes alive. But it's pretty important, Bradman, they're trying to chase a championship at this level of competition. Dropping 20 points like that's very expensive.
Very expensive. You need to be as dominant as Craig Lowndes has been through the championship to be able to do that and still get away with being a contender.
We take race cam down the front spoiler of the Castrol Commodore, and you're getting a bird's eye, or I shouldn't say a worm's eye view of the action right down on track surface.
It's through Repco Turn and into the back straight here at Calder. Well, not much of a straight there, but the back section of the course.
This is one of the most fabulous views you'll see of car racing. You can see how hard the suspension's working, how hard the tyres are working, the car sliding, understeering and oversteering as they pick their way through the circuit. 190 kilometres an hour through the flip-flop there. Perkins on the attack, runs right on the outside. And Johnson working very hard to hold Brock out. Look how close Brocking is now. I think that frustration is getting to him, really putting the pressure on Johnson as they swing back onto the straight once again. Look at Johnson right up on the ripple strips.
Well, this is Brock's opportunity. He hit that curb on the inside, which forced him to go out wide. Now Brock has to keep into it and try to get across. No, Johnson's cut his nose off.
Tremendous.
Very hard when you're that close and you see someone make a mistake. You almost need you do need the lift. And, of course, allows Johnson to gather up his marbles and continue onward.
Well, there are three teams renowned as the most powerful in V8 racing at the moment. The Shell FAI squad, the HRT Commodores, and Larry Perkins' Castrol car. And surprise, surprise, these are the guys doing the dominating at Calder today. A real horsepower circuit, incredibly long straight. And they really are opening the taps of these V8s here this afternoon.
Well, these are the three professional outfits. Well, along with Glenn Seaton, of course, make it four that are getting the big results. Certainly the Shell and HRT teams at the moment dominating the championship.
At Brock. He tries a different tack this time, right up behind the bumper of the Shell 17 Falcon last time into the Shell S's. This time he goes wide, tries to cut across. His brain will be doing the big scan of all the opportunities he's got available to him. But boy, Johnson's covering all his options at the moment pretty effectively. A bit further back in the pack, Wayne Gardner and Mark Scaife battling for 7th and 8th position. There's Tony Longhurst in 9th. 7th, 8th and 9th as they shuffle down toward the Shell S's once again. Carter in the Coca-Cola Commodore, very busy. Scaife in the Seeger Commodore right behind him. And Tony Longhurst trying to get his taste of the action too.
A little bit of smoke out of the back of Gardner's car there. Not sure if it's rubbing the tyre or just exhaust smoke. A little bit of blue smoke out of the right-hand side.
Under 6 laps to go. The battle continues between Johnson and Brock, and Johnson holds him out again.
You can see a bit of rubber marks on the front spoiler of Johnson's car. Getting very physical through here. You can see Brock, he's got the eyes on the open face helmet of the HRT Commodore. We take Castrol, oh,
there is here, Perkins. Gear there or something. Yeah. They grab a gear right at the top of that hill because otherwise the diff of the car jumps up in the air and it gets a lot of wheel spin and tend to over rev. So you just grab a gear right at the peak of that hill.
Well, that cost Larry a bit of time onto that back straight. Bit of a slow exit. 5 laps to go for our race leader, Craig Lowndes. He's opened it up 6 seconds. Russell Ingall.
We've got a bit of Castrol race cam here with Larry. The car's sideways there. He picks it up on the steering. Very nicely done. Larry would be just wondering, watching these two, hoping that they make a mistake and spear one another off. And just look how relaxed he is there with the steering wheel.
Side by side, 260 kilometres an hour. Brock continues to attack. He's more than half a car length in front now. Is he going to be able to sweep across in front of Johnson? I think so. Dunlop race cam shows you the action as we take roof cam and see Brock chop across in front of Johnson. He's been applying the pressure for 15 laps.
I think you find Brock will just disappear now. That was a good move around the outside. He'd been trying for 15 laps to get around there. I think he just got a better run out of the corner. But look at the distance he's pulled on Johnson already.
That puts Peter Brock into fourth place. Lowndes the leader, Ingle second, Bauer third, and Brock now in pursuit of him.
So 16 laps down, four to go for our race leader, Craig Lowndes, as he flashes across. Oh, Brock in trouble! After all that hard work to get in front of Johnson, he's lost it at the Shell S's. Gone right down through the back of the pack. Goodness me.
Race leader Craig Lowndes picking up the large slice of the cake here in the first heat of round six at Calder International Raceway.
Have a look at that replay. You can see Brock was all on his own, got past Johnson, but just went a little bit too hot into that corner, Brett.
Well, I think so. He's just got in a bit deep and locked her up, and the back stepped out and around he's gone. Very unfortunate, but he just got past Johnson, figured he had a lot of time to make up and was having a real go.
Battle continues for 6th, 7th and 8th position. Scaife getting in front of Gardner. And now Tony Longhurst in the Castrol Ford closing in on the bumper of the Coca-Cola Commodore. Decent sort of speed out of the Castrol Falcon this weekend.
Two laps left for the race leader, Craig Lowndes.
Lowndes, you can see at the bottom of your screen there. Ingle in second position. Great drive from the Castrol Commodore driver. Bow in third, Johnson in fourth, and Perkins in fifth.
Poor old Russell's been largely overlooked in this race because he's in a clear second space. Nobody's threatening him. He's not threatening Craig Lowndes.
Exactly. Sixth is Scaife, seventh Gardner, Longhurst, eighth Romano in the pack leader Falcon in ninth, and Faulkner rounding out the 10.
That smoke's still coming out of the back of Gardner's car. There's a lot of it coming out as he comes out of the Shell S's. There we go. A bit of a brake lock up there didn't help, but I'm not quite sure what that is. It's just a gentle puff of it coming out from time to time.
Here's our second place man, Russell Ingle, car 8, second of the Castrol Commodores, teammate to Larry Perkins, of course. And this enormously experienced open-wheeler driver doing a great job in his first year of touring car racing.
It was a tremendous start by him. Came off the fourth row of the grid and after a lap was in a clear second position and has not faltered since.
He's been doing a great job all year, Russell, in this car. The last lap we're on, Craig Lowndes, well into his last lap. Totally dominant performance at Calder this afternoon. Russell Ingle now in second position and he's some 10.18 seconds behind Lowndes. So Lowndes has just been playing with this field. He's our race leader.
No doubt about this young man. He does produce the goods. Certainly he's got the car under him to do it. They call it the HRT supercar, but boy, it's been a super drive again by him.
Well, the interesting thing at the moment is the only two people that are doing 57 lap times is Lowndes and now Brock, of course, back in 12th place, which is a bit disappointing for him. But after Phillip Island and all the damage HRT had there, they've got the cars repaired. This brand new car here, fantastic job by Lowndes to win this one.
He's going to win it and win it easily, Bradley. Over 10 seconds as he takes the checkered flag to win Heat 1 of Round 6 of the Shell Australian Touring Car Championship. Absolute daylight back to second position. Russell Ingle, powerless to do anything about the Holt Racing Team Commodore, weaving up and down the straight. They've been running low on fuel there. He comes second with John Bauer in third.
Shell race score shows us Craig Lowndes the winner. Heat 1, round 6, Shell Australian Touring Car Championship. Russell Ingle second, John Bauer third, then Dick Johnson, Larry Perkins. Sixth position went to Mark Scaife, then Wayne Gardner, Tony Longhurst, Paul Romano and John Faulkner finishing in 10th position. Pit stop after the break with Peter Brock.